management to statutory bodies. The council have its systems, it uses procurement, we have our systems, and so it's about trying to understand how we actually bring that together if we have an integrated solution. And finally, if you may, I think in the paper, there's four options that were considered on page 5, and we're recommending option 4, which is a joint commission and enable existing providers to keep their existing caseload post-award. So successful providers will be able to keep existing caseload and take up new cases going forward. And this again ensures minimum disruption for current people who are in the service and reduce the impact of reviewing the 1,400 cases and coming up. So I'll pause there. My colleague Jackie may well have a bit more detail on the moment of the commission.
Just a few other quick points to build on what Ian's sharing with you. I think it's important to acknowledge there's been significant work over recent months with our existing providers and stakeholders, which has got, I think, the market into a really good place. We have a really positive, buoyant, committed independent sector workforce out there, and as Ian's described, we have written into the paper the options that we have considered, and there's a very strong rationale and argument for workforce board going to tender with existing who have over the recent years, in terms of the background we've described in the paper, really committed to keeping the market stable when other providers have, for various reasons, exited the market. And they work really, really hard to keep people safe and to transfer existing services and absorb their staff and ensure quality services are delivered. So we very much want to recognise that and build upon their approach and commitment and dedication. And really move forward. And I think in fairness to those providers, they have absolutely worked to show value for money and worked to keep people safe. The market is currently reasonably stable. We do have a small waiting list. Providers have been working actively over recent months to get that down. And our aspiration is to have an absolute minimal waiting list with really responsive, robust services in place that can support people and pick up your refills 7 days a week. So that was the background around the reason for recommending option 4. And I think then just in essence, in terms of picking up the recommendations that Ian's made, we are really proposing an integrated commission. We are looking at the end-to-end, as Ian's described, and we do want a robust pool which arrangement in place. There is ongoing work at the moment to completely develop the service specification, and clinicians and providers are actively engaged in that work. It's not quite concluded yet, it will be around the end of August. And because we are now incorporating, we've identified additional spot commissions outside the current block and commission arrangements, we want to make a recommendation to put that spot commission into the budget, into the pool as well, which will be approximately in August. And on the back of that final work that will happen in August, the table that you have in the paper about the aggregated rate may vary just slightly once we've actually got to the bottom of exactly what that spot spend is and what that does to the aggregated rate. But they are predominantly small changes. So we're really asking for approval for the principles of moving on an integrated commission on the full budget and approval to finalise the commissioning specification and then the aggregated rate and a final one being system consolidated.
Thank you both, and thank you and your teams for the amount of work that again has gone into this. Can I open it up to anyone for comment, Alan?
Two questions, if I may, Chair. Firstly, I note the procurement timetable in the appendices has got every step very well documented. And I think what Jackie said earlier may have reassured me on this point, but are we confident that we can get to a position where the procurement will be completed by for an April start next year, given the complexities of the procurement arrangements? And I'll pause at that point because my second question is a bit of an issue.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Yes, we can give assurance on that. As I said, the providers have been actively engaged for many months. We're in a really good place. It's been some really impressive and very positive integrated work, and I can give that assurance.
Thank you.
Second question
very quickly on the risk register. The highest risk, both before and after mitigation, is staffing. And in the risk register system that we're all familiar with, that had a score of probably 20, which is pretty clear in red. So I just wonder to what extent any further mitigation actions are planned that may help that to be reduced.
Thank you for that question. Yes, as I've alluded to, without the detail, we've worked very, very hard since last summer, which is probably the worst summer we've had, certainly in the 5-6 years I've been with Rural in terms of being able to respond 7 days a week to pick up people requiring auxiliary support. We did last summer have a waiting list of about 85 people waiting on auxiliary care. Today, as it stands, we have 36 people waiting on auxiliary care. I think that shows where the market has got to, been working with us constructively to look at creative solutions. We have a number of pilots in situation at the moment where we're trying different approaches, different things, and we've currently got some quite a strong strategy in place at the moment, actually looking at what we do between now and the autumn to get that waiting list to be over 25, which we believe is a sustainable position. And that includes looking at career pathways with our NHS colleagues, looking at the council and supporting a rural-wide recruitment drive with our independent sector providers, and really putting a bit of funding into that, selling the positive stories, getting some good press publicity. And we're also finally looking at some new sampling, existing internal health staff to complement the elements of that complex part of the commission where people do actually need some healthcare support as part of that domiciliary package. So looking at creative ideas about existing staff and how we can bolster that market. Independent sector providers are very, very on board with that, and we're encouraging them to come up with their own ideas as well.
Thank you very much. A very comprehensive response.
The workshops I attended with Jane with the providers over between May and end of July. The two things that came off was around future staff requirements and the issue around come summertime, come winter, come Christmas time, some of these staffing aren't available. It was the length of contract, adding stability into the market. And linked to that quite a lot, the open book accounting, because as I explained to me and I understood it, the ability then for providers and commissioners to understand. So what is the real cost of your service, the budget this, where we can help you find efficiencies. And those efficiencies are not lost to public services. They're available potentially now for providers to think about their hourly rate.
Yes.
That was the type of conversation that was well received and well understood by the providers in the workshops.
Sure. Well, that's fine. Thank you, Ben. And as I said, Jackie's comments were reassuring as well. I would suggest, if this board is minded to recommend this process, that during the procurement period we get an update on where some of those activities are taking us in terms of staffing, so that we can hopefully see that risk reducing. Thank you.
Thanks, Alan. So, Simon and Bernie.
We are not privatizing this, we are not doing. from. I think we're very clear about the benefits this brings, and which I support the recommendation in the paper. So this is about keeping people safe, because if actually you have a stable care market, you're more likely to keep people, the recipients and participants hopefully in that care safe. You're more likely to provide continuity of care, because they will get to know the people from the services, which is highly important to many people, and comes up time and time again, like knowing the people who are coming into your house, your home, and knowing they're treating with dignity and respect. I think it is about us working with the wider rural system, certainly with people like educational bodies, the Chamber of Commerce and so on, about making caring a really inviting career opportunity and profession. And I think offering people their roles beyond domiciliary care and perhaps into the wider health and care market as a whole is where we wish to be. And so that's what the workforce strategy around healthy rural is going to look at. And I suppose finally it's therefore about employing local people and providing jobs and thus the economic benefits that brings to our community. So I think those strategic objectives absolutely sum it up about sustainability, focus on health, well-being, independence of the people of Wirral, also a vibrant market that's locally focused and locally sourced in terms of the people working there.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Sue. I just really like to say, I know that the domiciliary care market has been an absolute nightmare, and I think for Jackie, Jane, all the people who were working on the last summer to really try and support that market. So I think it's really great that we're in a good place now with rural-based providers. I think the social value, clause, I'm really, really pleased about that. And I think this is one of, it's a really exciting opportunity to get this paid right for people. I think on a personal level for people, this is really going to help people to stay in their own homes for longer, which is where they want to be. And I think the fact that it even takes an end-of-life care, you know, it's got to be a fantastic thing for rural people. And I'd just like to thank the baby for all the hard work, as well as Jane and all the team. I think it's a really great piece of work.
Yes, Karen.
Thank you, Chair. I just want to make a remark. I'm very much putting us to conversation with the NHS at the back door. That's not something that anybody sat around the table idly wants to happen. I do believe that the disability, health and social care, mental health integration will deliver the best care available with the combined resources and expertise, putting the patient and all clients at the heart of the service. And I think that this is the best way in the right way forward. So I would support this.
Thank you. Any further questions or comments from anyone? Right, thank you very much for your work. We have a series of recommendations, so I think the two of us will have to take those through. My understanding is that we are asked to allocate as action the use of the pooled budget to agree the development and deployment of a centralised system of commissioning, to approve the first parent support commission for forward commissioning plan with integrated governance. Now, a bit on the following page about approving the award presentation, we're just simply asking for us to have it back. It's not a task like to take the task on, but it's not ready to do that, is it?
It's entirely your decision. You can approve us here to then award the post-tender process and then bring it back here, or we can bring it back here before we approve and make a recommendation.
Okay. So, Co-Chair, Joint Chair, are you clear on all that?
Yeah.
I'll leave it with you and your council members first then.
Councillors, are you happy to take the recommendations on page 377 and 378 as they are?
Yeah,
unanimous.
Thank you. And as the CCG members, whether they're happy to recommend these recommendations to governing. body in a fortnight's time. To just, in the list that I put them through are any concerns about that. There was a specific question though at the end about, if I understand it, whether we want a further report prior to the award of the tender, or whether we just want to be informed about the award of the tender. Do we have any opinions about that? I ask both committees then.
I thought the report would be coming back anyway.
Yeah. On the 5th of February. Prior to award. It says post. So, prior to
my award. Thank you. I want to see all the other back. It will be coming back here for an update report on the 5th of February. And we can make recommendations from that.
Yeah, okay. That's why I just thought that's important that we were clear where the decision making was.
Just on that point, it talks about a 3-month period of preparation essentially for the successful tenderers. If we don't formalise that decision until February, is that giving them enough time to have that process completed in time for 1st of April?
Thank you for that. It would be more helpful if you would authorise approval for us to go ahead and award a post-tender. We can keep this board informed. We will be doing an update report in February regardless. If people feel uncomfortable with us making that approving award without it coming back here first, then we can just consider that to them. To be honest, we will start those handover plans. You know, because we know we're going to the market, but we're trying to place them in the 3 months.
Can I understand exactly who you mean by us?
The board, the education board here.
No, you talked about us making the decision without it coming back.
Yeah, so if you're giving approvals to progress the teething, decommissioning the tensions, we will go, we'll finish the detailing all goes down, we'll put it on the check, we'll go to tender, we'll go through due tender process. We can today make a recommendation and approve that we can then make a decision at the end of the tender process of what we're awarding and how, or we can bring it and update you, or you can ask us to come back with our recommendation before we confirm that decision.
I need to look to my director of commission. The suggestion is there's a possibility of delegating it to officers.
So
I'm thinking about the position of government body.
Okay, so in a little bit more respect, what we're doing historically with any procurement process is ensure that the process was carried over, of course, and we do not make a judgment on the outcome. And so if the assurance is then allowing that for you, the CHESS process, if that's a solid and robust process to procure safely, then I think we can safely say that that's duly followed. The outcome will be what the outcome is. Process that Jackie's outlined to say that we've also been happy with the outcome provided and our process has followed.
Our CCG members are happy with that. Okay, it's my turn. Bernie.
I was just wondering, may it be possible between now and February, is there any way of having some safeguard processes in there to ensure that the process is going ahead so that you don't end up with the situation in February where there's an objection to it and then within the group being away? So is there any way of having some checks and balances from here till February to ensure that the process is duly being followed?
Okay, so again, just to use previous examples, what we've done is, in terms of the process, we do updates via an email because up until the contract is almost already in private anyway, so it can be commercially sensitive. So there would be no problem if Jack's able to do that, to provide updates with, you know, for example, the procurement framework that's going to be used, or kind of waiting with the gates at various parts, just to assure you that it's been done in a robust fashion. So providing that's okay, I would say that's fine.
Okay, paperwork, and I'd actually like to say three reports that have come from business have been presented in a way that shown a huge amount of working that's so helpful in terms of our discussions here. We're clear about the work that's gone on behind it. That's really helpful, thank you all. So that's the end of our core business. The date of the next meeting is the 16th of October, which will be chaired by Chris, and will take place again here, same place. So can I thank members of the public for coming in to listen to our deliberations. That is the end of the public meeting. One item that is just an update to the councillors, so the CCG from the councillors can remain just for an update about something. Thank you very much. I'm very sorry, it's not a public meeting, it's a meeting.
Yeah, I just wanted to, sorry.